Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. In case you're joining us for the first time, we air every weekday on Thursdays at 10 p.m. on Urban TV. Better still, we stream online, by the way. You could watch us as you are on the move or get a repeat on Saturdays at 8 in the morning and see what you can pick off to better your business. Talking bettering business, we are now looking at how to make money for this week.
My name is Benjamin Wandera and I work with Urithi Studio. Urithi is a continuation from Mango Tree, former Mango Tree Educational Services, which used to deal in educational material for 2021. We picked up from there with a team of about seven and started the same venture. Now, what Urithi aims at is into communication and social change material. Any material that's aimed at improving the daily lives of the client is what we go for. Like it's, as you go through on, because we have very many companies that come to us, but how many emphasis is on social behavior change? How does the information affect the person on ground? How does it improve them? And how does it help them transist?
Okay, thank you for speaking to us. Just tell us a bit about why, of all possible business ideas, young people like you could choose to do this?
As you go through life, that a lot of things that happen. However, at the end of the day, availability of information is also key to improving livelihood. For example, there's so much about sustainable farming, but what are the nitty-gritties about it? How do you break it down to the simplest form that a farmer down there can understand? For example, you may bring in all manuals and all this information, but it's not broken down in the right form. The information as good as useless. So what we aim at is making the information as understandable as possible. So that what we usually do is that we involve the clients. We don't do this information alone. We involve the clients from the first step, second step, third step, all throughout the level, so that we come up with the information that's understandable and also attainable.
What makes this unique?
What makes this unique is because we co-create with the clients themselves. We don't just sit in the office and make information that we hope they will understand. We go directly to them, come up with the information and how it will suit them. Most of the information here is tailored for the different communities. What will work here and what will work there because of the different problems. For example, for this client, as you can see, it's a comic about disability and inclusion. This is best suited for the clientele in South Sudan, and it may be applicable here, but the impact may be low. So for clients here, we do the same. We go down there, co-create with them, come up with data and information, which later is turned into information that they can end up using.
Okay. You talk about clients, and I'm thinking, who are your clients really, mostly? And for the years you've been, you say what, 2 years now?
We made money in existence, but however, most of the staff were under Mango Tree, so we just mainly transitioning and continuing what they used to do.
Okay, so what are some of the things you think you've done? What kind of impact have you created using this kind of platform?
Okay, for the biggest client we have, we're working with GADC, and we're working with soy and sesame. However, what we aim at is improving the farming practices throughout the value chain. That is from site selection, clearing, planting, harvesting, post-harvest handling, and also selling them. Well, the impact is through information that we have created, we've been able to affect the people and also improve livelihood through the material that we produce. And with different partners, we have seen actually a great improvement in the practices. For example, we've been doing farming material for soy and sesame. And after the training materials have reached the clientele, we have found that it has improved on the yield and also other farming practices throughout the value chain.
Okay. So your team of young people and for the last about 1 year you've been doing this now.
Yes.
If someone asked you in the next probably 1 year, where do you see this company going? And do you think you'd want to grow it to have more young people join you?
Well, this is a useful company and very much growing the company. However, we need to take baby steps at this, since it's not really complex, but it takes a lot, conceptualization, ideologies. So this is something that we're building on, and in the next 5 years, we hope to achieve that information out there is useful. Not in abundance, but it's useful to the client.
Okay.
Most of us have. Our previous working experience has all brought us here, so we've owned our experience in doing this. This is something that we love, and this is something that we're willing to actually take on in the next number of years. So it doesn't matter if it's 10 years, 20 years from now, we shall be doing something that we love, and this is it. So what I can say is that we shall push doing this, and patience is one of our virtues.
So probably one of those obvious questions is, what are some of the challenges that are involved in this kind of work, which I really think is quite tedious?
Well, I would look at the challenge, but information keeps on changing, and you find that you have to tailor material to the satisfaction of the client. However, this is something you do over and over again. You end up doing things almost 10 to 20 times, but you come up with that one perfect piece that will be useful to them. So if you're not good at that, you may actually end up disagreeing with the client, but this is something you're used to, and this is something you're carrying on doing. That information comes through a lot of scrutiny and also planning. For example, that has gone through almost like about 4 phases of visualization, and helps depicts what happens at the lower stage. For example, for the client in South Sudan, and talking about disability, how would a child enrolling in school disability affect them? What would they aim at in the next, for example, 10 to 20 years? So we came up with material, these illustrations, like that child with one leg being taken into school, talks about inclusion and what they hope to achieve. So one chart shows the child at school. Second part, child is enrolled at school. Third section, the child is getting to the school system and answering questions. And the fourth is more like a victory round, whereby they're graduating. Mm. Simple information, but at the end of the day, it has a big impact.
My name is Namba Jessandra. I'm the production lead for Ethi Studios. And what we normally do, when the client comes in, after the first stages from the offices and the computer, they send a sample to us, which we make as this. We make it in English so that we give the client a final product to see and approve. If it's exactly what they had asked for, then they bring them back in the company. Then we produce as many copies as possible. Mm.
All right, so you talk about it coming from the computer and then to this. So when it comes here, what do you start on?
What do we start on? We have a stencil, which we start on, which is later on given to the artists to sketch, make illustrations, blank illustrations without colors. After it's done sketched, it's brought to the next team, which put in the colors. So we use 5 primary colors of the markers. So these are the main markers we use. And from these, we have the different colors. As you can see, we have brown on it. There are some charts with lemon green or orange and all the other colors. So these are the main markers we use. And then we have a marker. We get one old marker that has no ink in it. We put spirit inside, so it fades the color to give it harmony, and that's how we make the shades of the color.
Right, so looking at the raw material, call it raw material or whatever it is, yes. Why do you choose to use this and not vanillas per se?
We choose to use the grain tuck because it's long lasting, weather friendly, and it catches more people to use it. Why? It's not common on the market, and most people find it really hard to tell that we have used markers to write and draw even the smallest image. So that makes it more useful to the client, because there are not many companies that use the grain tuck.
Is it costly to buy this then?
It depends. I would really say it depends on the market, how the price goes. Yes.
So I see you have a team of young guys and ladies trying to paint and stuff. How do you even get them? Must they have studied a particular course, or how do they even apply to work with you?
We do not really get people who have studied a course in designing. We go for teenagers or for graduates who have just left school and they're looking for what to do. So we train them and teach them how it is done, how it's drawn, what are the specifics that we need, and once they pass that level, we start giving them work to do.
So about how long does it take for a trainee to start and be able to put out something that is final and the client can?
It depends on someone's capability. One person can take a day, the other person can take 2 weeks, the other person can take 4 days. It depends on what effort and the capability the person has put in. Yes.
So I've seen you you have some translations as well.
Yes.
What impact does that create?
This helps the person on the ground to understand it much more better. The people who are not educated and cannot read English, but they can read something in their local language. So like this, it is in Acholi. So someone from Gulu can really read the word and understand it compared when I give it to the person in English. So they're able to relate to the information on the chart in their local language than in English.
Okay.
Yes.
So of the content that you produce, what are some of the most, the common sectors or industry or areas that most clients look into?
Agriculture and early childhood materials.
And why is that so?
Learning how to count the alphabet, 1 from 10, 1 to 100, learning parts of a flower, depending on the clientele.
So in business, it's a whole value chain thing. So when you get the idea and it works and then you implement it, you start making the money. The question is, how do I save the money? But if you have the idea and the money doesn't come through just as yet and you want to start, that will talk to us about personal finance tips, which is the last episode of the 4-part series that we've been running with the CEO of Med Business Consult. He's a mentor and a business coach as well. So we've talked about several things that you need to do, and this week, to wind up the month, we are talking about preparing an elevator speech. Now, just, you know, an elevator speech is a brief or carefully constructed statement that outlines the merits of your business. Just let me run you through the different things you need to pay attention to as you organize that speech that could sweep off a potential person to support your business.
Hi, good evening viewers. This is Inoth Mbene, your business coach, once again. Last week, we looked at the various sources of finance for our businesses. And this particular episode this week, we want to look at another yet interesting topic. Now that you've known where to get these sources of finance, where to go, how to go about it, I think it's now paramount of paramount importance that we see how we can prepare on how we can present our case. And this brings me to the topic of preparing an elevator speech. An elevator speech is a clearly well-constructed speech or statement on how your business is going to operate and how it can convince potential investors. You have talked about the idea. You have looked at the market. You have looked at all the various sources of finance. Now it's time to go into action. So how do we go into action? So the first step is to have a clear message of your product or service that you want to sell out there. That can convince somebody to give you money. And this is what we call an elevator speech. How do we prepare an elevator speech? One, the first step is to describe the opportunity or the problem that your business addresses. Is it looking at addressing a certain gap in the market? Is it looking at coming up with new ideas for the business? What exactly is the problem that you're addressing? This needs to be very clear in your statement or in the speech when you're communicating to your potential funders. Then, secondly, the second step is how is your product or service going to actually meet or going to address this problem? How is it going to address the needs of that problem? This needs to be very clear. So you have created the research, you have analyzed the concept, and now you need to come up with various ways of how your product is going to address the needs of the problem out there. Thirdly, your investor or the potential investor or the person wanting to give you money is very interested to know who is this person behind the enterprise. What are your qualifications? What is your experience in this business? How much have you invested in terms of your time? What skills do you have for this business? For this person to be comfortable and say, yes, I'm willing to put in my money into that business. So that's very key. What is your background? What are your qualifications? What do you have that it takes to push this business further? And then lastly, is the most important, which usually the investors look at, and that is the market. How have you addressed the market? Is the market actually there for your product or service? Have you invested some time in conducting a market research or a market survey to show the viability or the feasibility of your product or service? What is the market segment? Are you going to target the older people? Are you going to target the youth? Are you going to target women? How have you segmented the market? So the market is extremely important when you're preparing this speech, and this is what they want to hear. So ladies and gentlemen, as you're going out there, package your product very well. Package your speech very well to be able to wow a potential investor. I thank you and good luck.
So we thought we could share this with you, and I tell you what, when you meet a potential investor, the first question they ask you is, why do you want to start this business? Now, for you that is looking for money, if your first answer is to make money, I tell you what, you won't get anyone sponsoring a business. Most people want to hear things that impact society. Is there any group of people that you want to change in society? Is there a goal that you want to attain in society before talking about making money as an individual? Listen, these investors or these funders know for a fact that for every business person, the end goal is to make money. But some people are out there with money and they are ready to support you only if you are able to do something that helps other people. I keep saying on this show that your business idea should be one that looks at improving societal needs, not your desire to make money. So I should say shouts out to the CEO of Business Consult for the 1 month series that we've been running on the different things. We've talked about alternative financing, sponsorship for your business, how to align yourself for partnership so you can be able to start your business. And this week we have talked about writing that elevator speech that could sweep off that potential investor into your business. Let's run you then through Forex and money market report for this week. So if you've been doing the same thing and not getting results, then sit back, don't give up. If it's very clear you're doing the same thing the same way and you expect different output or outcome. Sometimes the turnaround things that will happen in your business will keep changing as the day goes by. Look at the market dynamics before you think of what you need to change about your business. You cannot keep doing the same thing. You cannot keep using the same marketing strategies. Okay, sometimes it depends on the how long, because there are strategies that will work after the how long. Maybe people need to understand what you're up to first, then the business can pick up. But if you're doing the same thing and it's been a while now and not getting anything different out of it, then you might want to start thinking otherwise of how can I improve my business moving forward. So turnaround management is something that you need to look into. And recently I was speaking to a colleague, Vincent Kagame is a business rescue doctor, and was telling me he's looking into speaking to businesses on how they can a pattern, you know, like strike a partnership, and then he offers the guidance on how you can revamp your business. And then along the way, if your business picks up, then you're able to pay him something. Now, this actually will address one thing. We know for a fact that most businesses will tell you they're not in position to finance the experts to come advise them. So if you can have something like this with Vincent, I hope he starts it soon, yeah? Then you can strike that partnership that can help you moving forward. Like, try to understand, do you need to downsize? Do you need to bring in new products? Do you need to, you know, put more money into your business to restock? Or you need to just take a break, pause, wait and see what happens with the markets. Then you can go again. We hope this works for you. Now, before we go for this week, the business quote will be, do not save what is left after spending, but spend what is left after saving. Most people save after they have spent. You should actually be spending after saving. My name is Simon. For me and the team, we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.